Praise the Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to Holy Communion. I'm your host, Dr. Stefeni. Let's pray. Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving overflowing our hearts and lips. We praise you, Lord, love you, and adore you. We thank you that as we seek you, we are continually imparted with your wisdom and knowledge, and as we apply that wisdom and knowledge to our lives, we see dunamis power, exousia power manifest in our lives. Your word tells us in Proverbs 4, verse 7, that wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and in all of our getting to get understanding. We are here today calling on your presence to enlighten us and illuminate your word so that we gain the proper understanding of it. We thank you for the Rhema word of God, the Logos word of God, for impartation and the gift of utterance. Thank you also for revelation knowledge and the manifestation of your word coming to life so that we may put action to it in our daily lives. Bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more personally and love you more deeply. Holy Spirit, we invite you right now to take over this broadcast in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You know, my friends, did you come expecting to receive from God today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from him. So elevate your expectation level and you'll come away with a greater head and heart connection and a better understanding of God's word. Now, as we begin our lesson today, take a second to assemble a small piece of bread or cracker, a small portion of some kind of food item, and a swallow of some sort of beverage or juice. It can even be water. Set them aside. Later on, we're going to pray over them and sanctify them as the body and the blood of Christ. These are known as the elements of the covenant, and when I call for them later on in the broadcast, it will be these items I'll be asking you to bring forth. Now, as we move deeper into the Word of God, we learn more and more about being in Christ. And we find that these subjects are so deeply rooted in God that we need to do something extra in order to enter God's presence to the necessary degree for us to gain total understanding of His message to us. We know that soaking in worship opens that door. So right now, soak with me. Thank you. Today, we continue our program on a subject that we take for granted, and yet we really need to understand it so that we tap into and receive all the wonderful aspects of it in our lives. That subject is Holy Communion. Now, having established that the Holy Communion is God's channel of health and wholeness for His people, it's time to find out how to experience that divine life that comes through discerning the Lord's body. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 29 through 30 says this, For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. Notice that Paul said that it was not a failure to discern the blood, but a failure to discern the body that caused the people to be weak and sick and die before their time. So today, we're going to talk about what it means to examine yourself. You know, we've been talking about understanding what it means to discern the Lord's body regarding communion, and we have talked about the possible misconceptions that people get under because of a variety of church doctrine that we pick up like rolling stones as we go from church to church on our journey to find Jesus and a church home. We're going to look at what it means to examine oneself. First, we have to think about this. Excuse me. First, we have to understand the context of Paul's statement. We're going to look at his statement. He's addressing the issue of eating and drinking unworthily. So it follows that he was telling the Corinthians, that is, that they should examine themselves to see if they were eating and drinking in a worthy manner. Nowhere does it say that he told them to examine themselves to see if there was sin in their lives. Let's take a look. 1 Corinthians 11, 27 through 29. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. All right, now looking at this passage again, it's clear that Paul is saying that a man should examine himself to see if he's eating and drinking worthily, so as not to eat and drink judgment to himself. And it's so simple, but preachers have for so long made Christians fearful and sin conscious, and he just wants us to be sin conscious. He just wants us to examine ourselves to see if we're putting our faith in his son's work on the cross for us. So what does it mean to drink judgment to yourself? Well, this judgment doesn't mean God's anger or wrath. I used to think that, but God showed me the truth. In some circles, people still believe that the judgment here refers to God sending them to hell. That's an incorrect interpretation. The Greek word used here is krima, which means divine sentence. Then, when Adam sinned against God, a divine sentence fell on the human race. Weakness, sickness and disease are some of the effects of that divine sentence. Now, as long as we are here on earth, our bodies are subject to the aging process, which is part of that divine sentence. And all our bodies are decaying every day. Our brain cells are dying daily as well. And the Holy Communion is God's solution for us to offset the decay. Even your friends will see the results. They'll begin to ask you things like why you seem to look so much younger. You just never seem to age. And one day when we get to heaven, we will have brand new bodies that never grow old, never tire out, and never look bad. Meanwhile, the Lord's Supper is how God helps us offset this process of aging and walk in divine health. Every time you partake, you are reversing the effects of the curse or divine judgment in your body. Now, I want you to know something. The devil's no match for those of us who believe in the power of the Lord's broken body. And when I'm talking to you about these things, naturally, it's going to seem redundant because I'm going to go back over things and say them again. But we need to drive these points home, so please bear with me. You know, forever the devil has been trying to blind the church to the power of the Lord's body, and the reason is because he knows that he is no match for those who have faith in the power of Jesus' broken body. There is power in the act of eating. In the midst of intense spiritual attack, we will experience victory when we believe that what Jesus did on the cross is greater than any act of the devil. Now, once we realize how much Jesus suffered so that our bodies can be made whole, we will be confident that partaking of his broken body will bring healing to our bodies. If you still find it hard to believe that eating a small crumb can bring your body health and wholeness, let me point you back to the Garden of Eden. Remember that it was there that Adam merely ate of fruit, and he plunged the entire human race into sin. Think on it. His sin was what brought disease and ultimately death to all of us. So God, in his mercy and wisdom, devised the perfect solution. Since the simple act of eating by Adam brought disease and death, then God ordained that the simple act of partaking of a crumb would bring health and wholeness to his people. So this series of explanations should make you want to partake in Holy Communion at every opportunity that presents itself. You know, before you partake, you know that you're about to release your faith for your forgiveness and healing. Before you partake, you know that God wants you to prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2. Prepare the bread and the wine. Now, this is how you prepare, because you're going to be doing this at home, but I'm going to go on and talk to you about this. Prepare the bread and the wine, the juice, water, or whatever beverage you have, and do not be in a rush when you do it. Remember that this is not a ritual. You're about to personally experience all over again Jesus' love for you. Hear him say to you in your spirit and mind, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. See his eyes burning with love as he says to you, this cup is the new covenant in my blood which is shed for you. Visualize the Lord carrying all of your sins and diseases. He took your sins in his body on the cross. See him taking on his body, all of your physical conditions too. If you have a tumor, see that tumor on his body in the same place that you have it. Whatever disease you might have, see it on his body. It's no longer on you. See his vibrant life and health come on to you and into you. Surely he bore your sins and carried your diseases. So as you partake, release your faith in the bread and the wine. Hold the bread in your hand and say this. Thank you, Jesus, for your broken body. It is for my healing, my spouse's healing, and my children's healing. Thank you that by your stripes, by the beatings you bore, by the lashes which fell on your back, we are completely healed, made whole and well, nothing broken and nothing missing in any of our life. Then eat the bread. Next, take the cup in your hand and say something like this. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the new covenant cut in your blood. Your blood has brought me forgiveness and washed me from every sin, past, present, and future. I thank you that your blood has made me righteous. As I drink, I celebrate and partake of the inheritance of the righteous, which is preservation, healing, wholeness, and prosperity. Now drink the beverage. Thank you, Jesus. I love you because you first loved me. Amen. Now, right now, if you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to be in Christ and avail yourself of his marvelous wisdom, you must give your life to him. You know, it's very, very simple and pain-free. And in just a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity. Oops, wrong one.
Called my name. Love. love came for me. If you had not come, willing, spotless lamb, my sin would be too much for you to take me as I am. But all the blood of Christ that washes over me, flowing from your hands, your feet, I don't have to worry where I'd be, 'cause love came. This manger came, my everything, love came for me.
Beloved, to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, sincerely with heartfelt repentance, come before the Lord and repeat this prayer. Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner and surrender my life to you. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for me and set me free for all eternity from all my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead and sit at the right hand of God the Father. Take over my life and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I renounce the devil and all sin. Lord, I receive from you the gift of righteousness, total forgiveness of all my sins, past, present, and future, divine health, wholeness, and restoration, your protection, direction, your provision, your peace, and the gift of everlasting life. I'm yours. Come into my heart and take over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, then you're saved. Welcome to the family of God. You know, my friends, I want you to listen to what our part in partaking of Holy Communion truly means. Then I'm going to play the song for you so that you can sing with it and feel it and get with the program. But right now I want to read this to you. Behold the Lamb who bears the sin, our sins away, slain for us, and we remember. The promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, torn for you, eat and remember. The wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King. The blood that cleanses every stain of sin shed for you, drink and remember. He drained us cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of grace around the table of the King. And so with thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. As we share in his suffering, we proclaim Christ will come again, and we'll joy in the feast of heaven around the table of the king.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread. Drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the king. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ tore. That healed the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one.
Received from taking Holy Communion is healing of our bodies and minds. And if you have an issue with those who take Holy Communion and don't receive their healing through it, know that that issue is rooted in lack of knowledge. We must prepare for before taking Holy Communion. And the first thing that we must do is discern the body of Christ. Well, what does that mean? Well, dear friends, I want you to understand something as I explain this. First, I want to touch on this. Jesus and his disciples had bread and wine on the table when they shared the Last Supper, food that was familiar to all of them. That's why we use bread and juice or wine for our Holy Communion. But it doesn't matter what food items you do use. Use what you have available to you. We pray over them, sanctifying them as the body and the blood of Christ. So all you need to do is believe that they become that body and blood. So we begin by discerning the body of Christ by acknowledging that the bread, or whatever you're using as the body of Christ, is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness, that because of his body and blood, you supernaturally have become bone of Jesus's bone and flesh of Jesus's flesh, that you are now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, completely restored to divine health and wholeness. You can think of it as a pill. It's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God, so bright you can't stand to look at it because you can't see it. It's just too vibrant. And it's healing you as it travels through your mouth and goes down into your body. It pushes out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, from the inside out. Visualize the condition you're plagued with, the sickness or disease being on Jesus's body. You then put whatever ailments are on him. Use your imagination. You're not giving him something he doesn't want. He already took it at the cross, remember? You see, the enemy is trying to trick you. He's trying to trick you into taking it. How? By deceiving you into thinking you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus took it already at the cross, you're already healed and made whole. So put that lying symptom back on Jesus, right in the same place on him that you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself with the solution. See yourself without the problem. This is called spiritual visualization. It's vital that you understand it and do it. The next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future. As the restoration of the blessing to your life, the power and the authority of God in your life in full operation. As receiving God's provision and protection. As receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, thanking God for his plan of redemption, that you've been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now, lift up the elements of the covenant before the Lord that I asked you to assemble early on in the program as I pray. Father, we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this bread becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed, made whole, and completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we are continually washed in the waterfall of his precious blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. My friends, the Lord's Supper is a feast. It is. It's a fellowship. It's actually a personal fellowship. It's a partnership with Christ. Now, partaking of one bread creates partnership between the members, the disciples, as well. It merges us all together into one body, known as the church. The Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. Continually take the bread, give thanks, break it, and eat it, and take the cup, give thanks, drink it, all in the remembrance of Jesus. Now, the Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often. Yet, Paul doesn't give us any instruction as to how frequently the Lord's really supposed to be. Supper is really supposed to be celebrated. He does imply, though, that it's to be done with frequency. Why? So that partaking of the Lord's Supper continually recalls to our mind our redemption by Christ from all sickness, all disease, and all sin. So, do it as often as you want to and need to. Now, remember, too, that you don't need a priest, nor do you need a minister or a pastor to administer Holy Communion to you. We who are born again are members of the royal priesthood, and therefore we have been given the authority and right by God to administer Holy Communion to ourselves and others. As we are instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you, so that every cell, tissue, organ, and bone, all systems, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, muscular, skeletal, all of them are totally aligned with God's word and his will, that you are and remain healed, made whole, and totally restored to divine health and wholeness. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The blood of our Lord Jesus, shed for you in celebration of the finished work of Jesus on the cross, for the remission of all of your sins, past, present, and future. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior. As I said earlier, the Lord's Supper is a feast. It's a feast in union with the living believers and the Savior, whereby we spiritually and by faith receive Christ with all of his benefits, and we're nourished with the vibrancy of his life, his divine health and wholeness, into eternal life. And for that, we are eternally grateful. Did you receive this today? I pray that you did. If you need further explanation of the message or understanding of it, contact me. I'm going to take this opportunity to announce our 2016 program changes and additions. We are taking hiatus from Living the Word since my co-host isn't available for a season. We will be resuming Living the Word broadcasts on Fridays at 9 a.m. Pacific time in the very near future. I'll keep you abreast and updated so that you can put them back on your calendar in plenty of time. Meanwhile, we've placed our new program, Holy Communion, into the Monday time slot, the 10 a.m. Pacific time, which is what we just did. Now, some of these, I want you to understand something. These Holy Communion classes that we're doing, some of them are short, some of them are longer. It just depends on how the Lord wants me to deal with things. But it's vitally important that you understand it. So he's kind of having me spoon feed it to you. So you may not get a lot of information at one time, and you may think that the information you're getting is redundant, but then faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Amen. Okay, now let me tell you about another new program, which you, not another one, but I'll tell you about the program that you've just experienced. As I said early on in some of my earlier classes today, the Holy Spirit shared with me that the body of Christ, the church, more often than not, takes Holy Communion by rote, without a thought to what it truly means, and without knowing what the effects of Holy Communion are. You know, we're supposed to take Holy Communion. It's a commandment to us to take it, to remember Jesus, to keep us always abreast and refreshed, and our focus on him and what he's done, so that we can glean the benefit of that salvation message that we took and have held it close to our heart, and we gain more understanding of who we are in Christ. Because if we don't understand something, we won't glean any good from it. Now, as a result of our learning about it, the Holy Spirit's led me to broadcast this program on Holy Communion so that you'll gain a proper understanding of it. The program comes to you every Monday at 10 a.m. Pacific time right here on Spreaker.com, and we delve deeply into Holy Communion, what it is, its importance in our lives, why we partake, and what to expect from having partaken of it. I want you to get that expectation of having what to expect from it. That's why we go through it like we just did when we partook of Holy Communion, where I explain the vibrancy of his life, everything. Those are the things you're supposed to be gaining from this. And it isn't just me saying it and you going, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's you listening, absorbing it, thinking about it, and doing it. Just as I teach you about that it doesn't have to be bread and wine. It doesn't have to be a pressed down wafer with a cross printed in it. You know, it can be a cracker, it can be a piece of bread, a piece of cheese, a piece of fruit, it can be a piece of meat. It doesn't matter what it is, provided that it's there and that you discern it as the body of Christ. Another thing, too, is, and I just want to caution you, keep in mind that you're not going to want to have a huge glass of it, of the the wine or the juice or whatever, or even water, and your or iced tea or whatever you're using. And you're not going to want to have a great big sandwich and call that, because what you, the reason I say that is because whatever you've blessed when we pray over it, and it's become the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, you have to eat and drink it all right then. You can't just take a bite out of the sandwich and then go do something and come back and take another bite. That doesn't work. So make sure your portions are small enough that you can handle them. And yet they can even be the size of a crumb. But that has nothing to do with what the lesson is. Now, let me ask you this question. As a born-again believer, do you really know who you are in Christ? Have you studied that? I mean, what does that really mean, even, being in Christ? Well, join my co-host, Dr. Sherry Thomas, and myself every Thursday morning at 9 a.m. Pacific time here on Spreaker.com for our new program, Life in Christ. We are taking you into the depths of what it means to be in Christ, and you're going to learn who you are, why you're here, what power you have, how and when to use it. You will learn who Christ is, not only as Savior and Redeemer, but his purpose here for you as your teacher as well. So be sure to join us for these broadcasts every Thursday at 9 a.m. Pacific time. You don't want to miss it. Now, my friends, I want you to know that we have two Sunday worship services for you here on Spreaker.com. 8 a.m. worship service and evensong service on Sunday evenings at 7 p.m. Pacific time. Come join us for worship and come expecting to receive. For a full programming schedule, please visit our website homepage, www.themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. Brethren, Proverbs 4, verse 7 tells us that wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all of your getting, get understanding. That's exactly what we're doing here, my friends, seeking for and gaining God's wisdom. So make sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. Holy Communion program is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International, a 501c3 organization. I just want to remind you that what's tomorrow? Tuesday? Tomorrow morning we have healing service at 8 a.m. Pacific, or no, 7:30 a.m. Pacific time, 7:30 in the morning here for the healing service. And then I have a whole slew of classes following that, but they're private tomorrow. So that's the only broadcast, but it's a healing service. If you need healing in your body, come, and come expecting to receive. Amen. All right. Have a blessed and wonderful week. I'll see you for Holy Communion again on Monday mornings at 10 a.m. right here on Spreaker.com. And tomorrow morning at 7:30 a.m., 7:30, I changed the time because I have a class that conflicts, 7:30 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, or on the West Coast time, for the healing service tomorrow. God bless you and have a wonderful day and wonderful week.